In the 80s, rock had irony, flash, and more sex appeal than ever. By beaming rock videos around the world, MTV became music's first global network and created a powerful new corporate medium, complete with wild imagery and calculated self-censorship. At the same time, inner-city youth were improvising a controversial medium of their own in the form of rap. By the 90s, the scene had come full circle with alternative rock. The new wave would become a big business, but only by climbing up from the underground.
Ladies and gentlemen, rock and roll.
You'll never look at music the same way again.
When MTV started, we were naive and idealistic and hopeful. We thought, this is it. Everything Devo thought, everything we've been talking about, everything we've wanted to see happen, it's happening.
We want to create this thing called MTV. We want to create a new attitude. We were going to be the first TV network ever to sell the network identity as opposed to selling its programs.
Television used to be called the vast wasteland. That was before music television, MTV.
MTV felt very revolutionary then. MTV was very much in everybody's face, and there wasn't much on it.
We'd be in an airport, and people were coming up to all of us and going, "Hey, you know, where's your top hat? Or where's your motorcycle? Or what are you talking about? We saw you on MTV."
And this became the thing that changed MTV's relationship with the music business. When the artists started hearing everybody say, "I saw you on MTV," they started saying, "Saw me doing what? I saw that video where you were doing like this." And they're going, "I never saw that."
Doodle, doodle dee.
For months we were going, "We gotta see this MTV."
Wubba, wubba, wubba.
And the groups then got involved in the creative process.
We went to Warner Brothers and they said, "We're gonna do a video to Whip It." And they said, "Why? The song's already charting. What do you need a video for?" And we said, "Well, we just think we should do one, and we want to have this girl in her, and Mark's going to whip her clothes off." And of course, they said, "Absolutely not." And so we went and did it anyway with our own money. Step on the grid. Break your mama's back. This was the image of men and women as corporate advertising likes to portray them. You know, you're all American, kind of Budweiser kind of guys and girls. Good looking jocks and jockesses. Now whip it into shape. Shape it up. Get straight. Go forward. Move ahead. Try to detect it. It's not too late to whip it. Supposed to appear on the Lily Tomlin special the week this was finished, and she said, "Do you have a video for this song?" We proudly said, "Yes, we do," and we sent it, and she canceled us off the special. Whip it good. We thought that people would see the irony and the sense of humor in it. I thought it was pretty obvious we were doing satire.
You know, in those times seemed fun to do videos. There weren't too many of them, and it was fun to see yourself on TV.
You know, the first video we made, you know, Arlo Tur sailed in the car. We thought, you know, what is a video? We just didn't take it seriously at all. We went driving around, you know, the city and jumping in fountains and things. We thought it was ridiculous that we were doing it. And little did we know that that medium became such an important part of music.
The end of 81 is when we started touring with the Police.
Yeah.
And we opened for them, and that's really what blew the lid off of it. I mean, our record went to number one, and theirs was still at number six. We're sorry, but, you know.
The opening band.
Yeah.
In those days, it was very different. You know, you could make an album, you could make two albums, and the record company would still be behind you. It wasn't such a fast turnover as it is now. You know, there was much more... You know, the record company seemed to believe in development then. It wasn't about, you know, oh, if you put two singles out and you don't get your video on MTV, then you're finished. Do you really want to hurt me? At first, the sort of general consensus was that I would never be a pop star. They talked about releasing Do You Really Want to Hurt Me. I was dead against it. This shouldn't come out as a single, you know, this will be the end of us. And I was wrong. Do You Really Want to Hurt Me was just something very sincere, you know, that I'd written from a real life experience. It actually had black and white minstrels in it. It had black guys painted black. And for some reason, MTV decided that they couldn't show that.
MTV in early years was bullshit. I didn't understand it, never watched it, didn't care about it.
Break to lose, but these here breaks rock your shoes, and these are the breaks. Break it up, break it up, break it up.
So we have Curtis Blow with the breaks, you know, we have Melly Mel, Grandmaster Flash with the message. And they couldn't get arrested on TV. Rap not only had a problem with television, it had a problem with radio and black radio.
Here you have a community that had nothing to represent themselves, nothing. Everything was somebody else's expression of reality and society. So we were forced to take that, mutilate it, and give it back as our expression now.
At that time, breakdancing was a real big thing then. This is where you would have two males or two females or male and female compete against each other.
Breaks on a plane, breaks on a train, breaks to make you go insane. Breaks in love, breaks in war, but we got the breaks to get you on the floor. And these are the breaks. Break it up, break it up, break it up, break down.
And graffiti was a thing for all the artists.
Graffiti is not an art. But I can sure as hell tell you that that's a crime.
You could just jump the fence. It was like a schoolyard fence. You go into the yards and put your name up, and then wait for the train to go by, and that was your finale for the day. Wow, my name is traveling all through New York City.
Hip-hop is the umbrella. You know, the hip-hop is the way you move your body. It's the way you talk. It's the way you think. It's a sensibility. It's the way whether it's graffiti, whether it's popping and locking and breakdancing and everything else, it's the sensibility, and it's one of the richest sensibilities that's come along in a long, long time.
You had your solo rappers, Curtis Blow and then Melly Mel, but then you had the Furious Five, Treacherous Three, you know what I'm saying, Double Trouble. So this is how two MCs would do it at the same time. One for the money, two for the bass. Come on, Jay, let's rock this place.
Like this, y'all. I kick a ill style.
I know you will, child.
We come together, never ran and never will now. I come a long way.
Now here's what I say. Back in the days, get up on stage and cut the airplay. Because we're coming harder. We pick the victim and stick them and hit your daughter. We kick it around. We licky your mind. We pick it quick in the nine. I fought us for the bus shot.
But the first guy on a B-boy rapping tip, and what I mean by B-boy, you know, over break beats with a DJ and, you know, cutting it up. The first guy that fascinated me was Melly Mel because he was clear, he had a good voice, and he rhymed on beat, and his DJ was fascinating. DJ Flash was incredible.
I had come up with a mixing technique, which I called the quick mix theory, where I was able to take two copies of the same record on two different turntables and repeat the climatic part of the record over and over and over and over and over again.
And this was around 1979, where I kind of like saw this guy do. I said, this guy got it right. This guy's doing it right.
When we heard a rough draft of the message, it was The lyrics were quite dark.
Rats in the front room, roaches in the back, junkies in the alley with the baseball bat. I tried to get away, but I couldn't get far, cause a man with a tow truck repossessed my car. Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge.
We felt, why would the world want to hear something like this?
It's like a jungle sometimes, it makes me wonder how I keep from going under.
It was like an explosion. We would hear it on BLS. You turn a dial maybe two notches, you hear it again. You turn a dial to the left, four notches, you'd hear it again. It was all over the place.
It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under. It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under. Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head.
I was shooken up, a little scared. I grew up listening to my influences, like your James Browns, your Sly and the Family Stones, but to hear my own record like that, it was, wow.
I want my MTV!
We were playing probably about the same percentage black videos as we were white videos, probably about the same number of blacks that produce videos, black artists as white artists.
Sorry, MTV, but I've got to tell people this. I'm in New York. It's 1981. I get a phone call. Don Letts, we want to interview you. You're the man who makes the Clash videos. Fine. I go to MTV. I show up in the offices. Everyone's looking at me funny. You know, like I should have used the tradesman's entrance or something. Somebody comes down, calls me into an office, sits me down and says, Don, you have to understand that we have a little problem here. What the guy was about to tell me is he didn't realize I was black. He went on to tell me that at that time, the policy of MTV was to cater to a Midwest white audience. Therefore, they weren't really playing black videos. He even gave me an example of how strict this rule was. He cited a wordy Rapping Hood, which was a cartoon. It was an animation video. But he said, that sounds too black. So we don't play that.
We could not get Billie Jean on MTV.
CBS threatened to pull their roster unless MTV started to play, you know, black artists.
And I think the story that went around was Walter Yetnikoff, who was a legendary sort of pound the tables head of CBS Records. I think what happened was, I think Walter told Michael that MTV didn't want to play that video, and I had to. Boy, I went in there and I just told him, hey, you play this video, I'm gonna burn you down. You know, the big threats, and you know, made himself look good to Michael.
She told my baby there's two, three, and she looked at me and showed a photo. My baby cried, his eyes were like mine. Go and dance on the floor in the round, babe. People always told me, be careful what you do.
When they started playing Michael Jackson's video, they you know, considered that a great achievement. But, you know, I mean, if you're black, you remember Michael Jackson from 1969. So, you know, maybe it was a big turnaround for white America, but for, you know, for black America and for myself, I wasn't thrilled.
That was the beginning of music television. I think, you know, it was Michael Jackson, Thriller on MTV.
MTV and Michael rode each other to glory.
Hey, this is a rock and roll museum. You guys don't belong in here.
Somebody had to take the banner to the next level. And it had to be a group that was willing to do something that would be a milestone, not just another record.
When I saw Run DMC, I said, now this is how it's supposed to be done.
Those boys are death! They are death! Sucker MCs should call me Sire!
We put the record out, Sucker MC. We did a lot of praying.
When we put this record out, Sucker MCs, nobody had a rap album out, and we just wanted our record to play like some of the records on a big radio station.
MTV came along as everything was rolling right into place for us. Everything just falling into place. We couldn't stop it from falling into place after a while. And MTV, we got a call from Russell. Something called MTV added us, and it's the biggest thing to them. What's MTV? Yeah. All right, gather that together. We didn't know what MTV was.
Cable and Hollis.
But they're very excited over at the office that we're going to get regular rotation with Rockbox on MTV. You don't understand how big this is. All right, I'll tell D. D, we got added on something called MTV, and they're very excited about this. This is a major breakthrough. So we understood that they're happy, so it must be something big just happened.
But then we never slip no lashes, no curls, no braids. Easy head to still get paid. Jamaica cut the record up and down the front.
From when Raising Hell was a biggie, everybody wanted to wear the black Levi's and the black sweatshirts.
No friend of mine, don't want nobody's name on my behind.
Like everybody else thinks, besides rock and roll, okay, it's time to go on stage, give me my wardrobe. I need my sparkles, I gotta go look good for the people. When the people actually in rap and rock and roll just want to see you in your jeans.
Want to relate with what you are.
Yeah, Bruce Springsteen wears his jeans and you go ahead on stage. You walking around all day, it's time to go on stage, just keep walking up to the stage. Yeah. This is what they want to see. So that's what we did. And we brought what we was in the alley rapping. Oh, it's time to do the show. Well, then turn the camera on. Let's go with the same thing we were just doing in the house.
Now it's about that time for us to say that we're Run DMC and Jam Master J.
Everybody said, oh, that's real. That's what I want. We did what we were doing.
We took the beat from the street and put it on the TV.
Right.
My favorite rap album of all time, hands down, Run DMC, Raising Hell. 1986. I remember I was in a record store. I'm staring at this record. I couldn't believe it. I'd known the guys for 3 years, but I just kept flipping it around. I stayed in the record store for an hour. I said, man, this is how rap is supposed to be. Rap is really big time. This is how it's supposed to be.
We were getting ready to make a rap record over the beat, Walk This Way. Before rap records were made, we would rap over Toys and Attic. I was getting ready to rap over the first 3 seconds of the record. Psst, bat, ba boom, boom, bat. If them loud guitars come in, I'm mad. I would use 10 seconds at the start of the record. If it ever got to him singing, there's a problem, and I'm mad at the DJ.
Right.
Rick Rubin walked in and just took over and said, yo, let's really make the record over. Let's call these guys, which weren't doing that well at the time, and let's make Walk This Way over.
Joe and I flew in, and there were these three guys doing this thing called rap, which was relatively brand new.
Rick just said, just kind of play along and let's get a bass, you know? So I played the bass on it and it was, I kind of built this track up and they came in and rapped it and they kind of rapped whatever words they thought they were, which was kind of cool, you know?
He was mad at the fact that the rap black guys and everybody's like Run DMC made y'all back. After for a while, they were a little hurt by it.
Everyone was saying that rap is just a fad. Matter of fact, hip hop The whole thing is a fad, and it's going to die soon.
People said no way was rap going to work, even though I didn't care for it that much at first. I knew then that it was going
to
work.
A lot of R&B artists back in the days used to say all kind of things. Oh, it's not music. Rock and roll artists as well.
I just don't think it's the highest form of music that you can make because you're starting out with somebody else's melody.
I just took offense to that. I said, no, it's more than that.
They still say things like it's not music, it's garbage.
Rap short for crap.
Rap was computerized rot.
If Hitler was to make a song, it would be rap.
I first designed Public Enemy in the footsteps of Run-DMC, who I think and still think are the best rap group ever in rap music. So I designed my group after them, and I said, you know, after studying Run-DMC, I can't go wrong.
You recorded Criminal Minded, and that album was all about introducing the new style. That's all it was about, the new style. We are taking over the new style.
We came with a different ball game of consciousness, self-knowledge, but also on the musical end, we came with a faster tempo. You know, the biggest difference in It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back is that the beat range of a lot of rap records were 98, 96 beats per minute.
And here I come with hip-hop and reggae and 16-bar rhyme styles. Like, you know, that's it, that's all, solo, single, no more, no less. And at a time where people was going, he's this, I'm that, I'm duh, duh, throw your hands in the air, just clap,
And our stuff, you know, was like more like 109 beats per minute.
And the kids were just going crazy for the style.
All right, all right. Who the hell are you?
We're the band.
The band? Where's your instruments? What the... We only play rock music here.
Why dissing, man?
Rock and roll!
Yeah, dude, like, I think we're the band.
The first white rap that got across to me was the Beastie Boys, because they came from the same environment.
Them guys, there was some bugged out gentlemen.
The Beastie Boys outraged audiences as the opening act for Madonna on her 1985 Virgin Tour. In 1990, she outraged executives at MTV, who banned her Justify My Love video.
All sorts of artists who are using music in a not so central way. Something else is the center of what they're doing. For example, the highly controversial Madonna. People don't like her because she seems to use music as part of the package for herself. I say, well, why not? If that's what she wants to do, why does music have to be the center of the thing? Why can't lifestyle be the center and music be part of the presentation.
She just wanted to shock people, and that's all she was interested in doing, was shocking people.
All the people that have stood out and stood the test of time are people that have had more than just the music.
When video came about and we saw the groups making videos that were basically them sort of bouncing around, we decided not to do anything like that. Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree? I travel the world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something.
The English have this uncanny knack of like packaging, you know, giving something a look, a style, you know, and making it into a more than just a sound. I think much more so than the Americans.
So I wrote the actual script for the video Sweet Dreams as a kind of surrealistic short 3.5 minute film, largely influenced by Salvador Dali's Large Door and the idea of a cow coming and disturbing the reality of a boardroom meeting, or vice versa, a boardroom meeting being in the middle of a field of cows, to show the actual sort of uselessness and the stupidity of, you know, people making decisions that think are altering the world. Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree? I travel the world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something. Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree? I travel the world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something. But in America, obviously, it speeded up a whole process. You know, we didn't go there and tour for years and years and years, because MTV kind of did it for us.
I think it sped up the process. It didn't replace road work. And at the time, I remember having some discussions with some of my buddies. He says, hey, we don't have to go on tour anymore. Now we just make a video.
It certainly helps, you know, to have your video played 20 times a day on TV.
The trouble is with being a visual artist is that the visual aspects of one's art generally leave their marks more graphically than the more musical form of what you do.
I originally disliked MTV quite a lot because I thought it was a real safe player, you know. And I still think it does play safe in many ways, but I think that it's undeniably created a forum for some of the most interesting film and video work that's been done in the last 10 years.
It's like a lot of things today are forced on you, you know, in your ears, in your eyes, whether you walk down the street with neon signs, music blaring in lifts, in restaurants, and a lot of the time MTV can be like that. It's just like wallpaper blaring at you. But every now and then, you know, there's a great filmmaker or a great group that has a great thing on, and it's worth it for that.
Video is the worst thing that ever happened to music.
It's taken a lot of magic out of music.
What the video age and MTV has killed off is this whole thing about how now a song is this visual. You know, the great thing, you know, back in the early days was you could just sit there and hear these songs and make up your own images and find your own things in it and let your mind wander.
And artists that are actually not particularly over-talented, but because they look the part, become stars. Fortunately, we came in before that started. But I mean, would you get someone like me now that, you know, that doesn't look like $1 million? No, I don't think you would. If
if they're on television all the time, you've taken some of the thrill of it out.
Now, when I was a kid and, you know, David Bowie was playing at Lewisham Odeon, it was a big thing. It was like 6 months of waiting and it was exciting. You know, now you just turn on your television, it's like, oh, David Bowie, oh, yeah, Kiss. Oh.
I've seen things on MTV that have just made my eyes go like this. They're shockingly original and fabulous things. Some of the best video makers now can do things in a 4-minute pop video that they would never ever be able to do in any other forum. I'm thinking, for instance, of the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Sexuality personified, it's attitudes, it's all the things that your parents told you don't do, you can do. It's the freedom to express yourself, it's a good time, it's being alive. It expresses the times. It's a magazine, newspaper that's the truth. If you listen to rap today, it's all about the truth, which is all we all want, is just give me a little bit of truth. Middle America might be saying, not in my backyard. And they would never see what was going on if it was up to them. Out of sight, out of mind seems to be their credo.
As Americans across the country began to accept rap as a reputable form of music, the West Coast rappers joined in with an even harsher view of the inner city, gangster rap.
This is what this guy sees. This is what this child has seen all of his life. But when he put a beat to it and puts a rhythm, you say, ooh, you don't want to hear it. You understand me? But he's telling you, he's only telling you what he was raised around. This is what he is. This is in his environment. And he's expressing it the only way he knows how, or she know how, to express it.
I'm expressing with my full capabilities, and now I'm living in correctional facilities. Cause some don't agree with how I do this. I get straight and meditate like a Buddhist. I'm dropping flavor, my behavior is hereditary, but my technique is very necessary. Blame it on Ice Cube, because it's letting it get funky when you got a subject and a predicate.
Well, you know, N.W.A., niggas with attitudes. When I first heard their first album, Straight Outta Compton, I thought it was brilliant.
They said things outwardly on tape, on record, that people will only think.
Some say no to drugs and take a stand, but after the show, they go looking for the dope man.
Some things that you say and do go a long way to influence those that listen. And unfortunately, I feel, my opinion only, that it has only resulted in a lot of negativity within the black community.
It's not negativity, it's negativity. It's negative. And they represented for the West Coast. They actually single-handedly put the West Coast on the map. Ice-T was doing it. Ice-T was like the forerunner. He was like John the Baptist.
I created the crime run. I was the first person to really rap about crime.
More than the attitude in quote-unquote gangster rap, it's become a thing where a lot of the guys from the West Coast, with what's going on in the neighborhood, is blended with that particular type of music.
Oh man, it sound like you selling out to me, cause I'm from the ghetto, man. I'm supposed to stay in the ghetto all my life. We ain't never supposed to leave here. We black, we supposed to be poor.
Shut up, do you know how dumb you sound? That mentality will keep my people down. Nobody wants to live in an urban war. You live there cause your parents were poor. They live there cause theirs were also. Get yourself together, hit the gates, bro. You gotta get out, you gotta get out. Why? Gotta get out, you gotta get out. Why? Gotta get out, you gotta get out. Why?
Cause the fields are where you die.
And in sales, these guys go platinum and gold like we breathe.
And rap is going in so many different directions. It's a versatile music.
A lot of white kids are learning a lot about black people because of hip-hop. You know, we all get to learn about each other. Hip-hop is like the CNN for the youth.
You don't start a band to save the world, you know, you really don't. You start a band for all the wrong reasons, you know, just to make a big noise, you know. And and roar at the world. That's where it starts. And it's later on in life you develop a conscience. You know,
when you begin to get real popular, yeah. You know, you have to be careful that obviously there's not a dilution into some very simplistic terms of what you're doing.
America's future rests in 1,000 dreams inside your hearts. It rests in the message of hope in songs of a man so many young Americans admire, New Jersey's own Bruce Springsteen.
In every city, there's people going hungry. There's old folks whose social security checks don't get them through the month. There's people who've been hit by unemployment. There's people who the trickle-down theory of economics ain't trickling down do.
At the time, you know, part of the idea is I wanted the band to come out to be a bit, you know, of an alternative voice to the image of America that was being presented by the Reagan administration.
A main street's whitewashed windows, vacant stores. Seems like there ain't nobody wants to come down here no more. They're closing down the textile mill across the railroad tracks. Norman says he jobs going boys and they ain't coming back to your hometown.
Communications has affected so many things, you know, in music and even the Berlin Wall and Perestroika and Glasnost, you know. It's been very powerful and people see what's going on, you know, the information between videos and films and music and everything else. When people absorb this, how powerful it is, you know, that it changes and it pulls the walls down. And it wasn't Interpol or the CIA or anything else that turned all this stuff around. It was music, and it was video, and it was films and information.
This is your hometown. This is your hometown. This is your hometown. This is your hometown.
Well, I think rock and roll is very powerful. It's a tool for bettering the world these days.
The conveyances that give us rock and roll are contributing more to the change in society than rock itself. MTV, for instance, a channel which conveys rock and roll to us, actually instigated a whole method of trying to involve youth with changing politics and voting.
Yo, what's up? It's real popular in rap music right now to diss the establishment.
Oh, baby.
Or complain about the establishment's faults.
I wanna get whipped out.
What needs to be popular is getting y'all out there to vote, you know what I'm saying?
Trying to change the world with rock and roll is kind of a funny thought. I don't think you can.
I definitely don't think it has any power to change the world. It only reconfirms or reaffirms two people where they're at. One nice thing it does is it brings people that feel disenfranchised and lonely together.
The whole idea that we could change the world musically but with good thoughts, positive energy, good vibrations, we could write songs that would make people love each other and not hate each other, we could put an end to war and violence by just positive thinking, was really a wonderfully innocent idea. It didn't quite work, but it was a great idea.
You know, if you want to change the world, you have to get out there and you change it. You know, music is not going to change it. Music changes the way that you live in the world. It changes the way you see it, but it doesn't change the world itself.
Yo, I don't think we should talk about this.
Come on, why not?
People might misunderstand what we're trying to say, you know?
No, but that's a part of life.
I just remember Salt and myself in a studio at the time, and we were watching the news, and Magic Johnson just like came through the TV like, I'm HIV positive. And we just sat there and like fell like, oh my God. And it just hit us. And from that day on, it was like, oh my God. Because you know what I mean? A lot of people, that's home to us. That's like close. That's the circle we hang in. That's young.
Anyway, ready or not, here he comes. And like a dumb son of a gun, oops, he forgot the condoms.
Hey!
Oh well, you say, what the hell, it's chill. I won't get got, I'm on the pill. Until the sores, pores, and stuff pour down your drawers.
Ew.
He gave it to you, and now it's all yours. Yours.
We need, like, women to big up women now. Especially with all the, you know, how the guys diss the women. Gangsta, calling women hoes and bitches and things like that. And we kind of counteract that with the things that we say.
You know, even political songs become pop songs after they're old.
It seems to be that self-consciousness is what suffocates the kind of creative spirit in anything, but especially in rock and roll.
Look what you've done to me. You made me very famous, and I thank you. I know you like your pop stars to be exciting, so I bought these.
Between stadiums and excessive indulgence and the growth of the media and everything else, and the growth of the audiences and record sales and everything else, rock and roll became big, 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 big business.
I think U2's popularity is founded on several things, actually. One is that they write great songs. Two is that they work extremely well as a band. But I think, most importantly, people sense that their commitment is real.
Not many things travel well around the world because of the language. The one thing that travels well is rock and roll.
I remember in the Himalayas, up at Namche Bazaar, which is the last element of civilization, really, before you enter into Everest Base Camp area, Khumbu Valley. It's up around 16,000 feet. It is the highest point of any civilization. This was the model for Shangri-La, that old ancient movie and stuff. And I remember walking into a little box room, like a little warehouse area where they stored rice and grain, and there was a picture of Duran Duran.
In the last six years, I've been in 35 countries, many of them over and over again, in every single continent. And the name of rap, people say, well, do they like rap in China? I said, what the hell do you think I've been there for? You think I went over there to play ping pong or some shit?
He thought it probably would spread east to the East Coast, maybe somewhere down south, you know.
did I think it was going to go to, like, Australia and Africa and England, Paris? I don't think so.
Hip-hop started here, you know, one place, and it's all over the world now. You got Japanese MCs and all people from all nationalities rhyming on the mic.
You know, I've been to India and seen an Indian rap group rapping about things that are happening in that village.
There are cultures in the world that are disappearing, and to some people it's very important that they be preserved. How does that fit in with a system where in every country of the world now people want to watch MTV and play rock and roll? How are the young people going to realize the value of their own music?
What I'm excited about right now is that rock and roll is at this point of it's mutating. It's turning into something else. In fact, the term rock and roll is probably, it's over. And I'm just excited to be at that point where the ground is giving way. You can really feel it just about to go under our feet, and I just want to let go. I want to go with it.
I think that there's been sort of a bit of a revolution in popular rock and roll in the last few years with the success of Jane's Addiction and Nirvana breaking the ground. And I think that people were just sick of listening to crap on the radio. Bands left over from the 70s, still putting out albums, and that's what the radio stations were eating up, and the kids were just like, this does not relate to me, this is not my generation of music. And so radio stations picked up on it, Lollapalooza picked up on it, and here we are.
I think what I look for in bands more than anything is attitude. I think that, you know, America has a really, really good thriving rock scene, you know. People have got something to say, something other than, you know, cliches.
The reason I chose Lollapalooza as the name, the title for the concert, is because when I looked it up, this was the exact, the terminology. Something or someone great or wonderful. Two, a giant-sized lollipop.
It's like this alternative rock thing, you know. Like, I don't know how many times I've heard that word get thrown around, alternative, alternative. It's like, alternative to what? You know, I mean, the media has really sucked up all of it. You know, it's the, you know, main genre of music that people are, it's like, that's really popular right now. And, I think of alternative music, I think of, like, just something different from what's happening in the mainstream, you know. And this is about as mainstream as you can get, you know. Not that it's bad.
You know, you have a kind of multicultural event that's designed to open people's eyes up to new sorts of music they wouldn't have heard before and stuff. This is great. And I'm not sure if it's exactly happening that way. And I'm not really sure if this generation's eyes particularly want to be opened up.
It's really the only thing of its kind in the United States, so kids just want to blow off some steam and come to the big rock show.
Youth is all about bonding together in some way and rebelling against the older generations and everything around it. But I just don't see where the rebellion actually is.
The world is collapsing around our ears. I turned up the radio.
I might be a bit pessimistic, but I think that rock and roll is dead now.
Rock and roll is dead? What a silly statement.
Rock and roll has now become a conformity, which is completely anti-nature to rock and roll. Therefore, it's dead.
Everything behind, look into my eyes, listen.
Rock and roll, when it starts calling itself rock and roll, that's when it has its problems. Or when you have rock and roll groups talking about the same thing over and over again. When the musics expand, that's when it tends to do better. Same thing with rap.
Check it out! What are you saying? What are you playing? Who are you obeying? Day after day in, huh? Baby, baby, baby. Yeah, that stuff is driving me crazy. DJs communicate to the masses. Sex and violent classes. Now our children grow up prisoners all their life. Radio listeners!
A friend of mine who works in computers and high-tech industry said that for him, he saw a 21st century where people, to escape the high concept and the agonizing realization that we no longer understand or control our technology, would want to go home and touch something made of wood. And I think that is kind of the place that rock is taking. Things like grunge for me and Eric Clapton and rap have a small, comfortable feel about them. They are almost tribal. They're things that you can touch. They're made of wood.
Rumblefish breaks heads like dishes. Rumblefish is quicker than other fishes. Rumblefish, cause he's the big fish with the death wish, acting like a Waco from Texas. Flexes as he flaunts in the stolen Lexus. Don't give a damn, cause the man don't respect us. But this is the plot. Three kids at the bus stop. Bum rush the ride. Now who's the big shot?
Rock, you can't kill rock because it will always exist. As soon as you assume it's dead, up pops Nirvana or some other thing. They'll try and sell it, but the underground is always 10 steps ahead of the lawyers and accountants, and so there will always be rock and roll or hip hop or whatever, underground music.
And then now it's rock and roll. Now it's amazing to see black people do rock and roll. Wow, you're black and you have a rock and roll crew? Wow. That's what happens when the rebellion leaves the music. It becomes Americanized. And I think that it's inevitable for music to become watered down. It's inevitable. But the point of keeping it rebellious is to keep people's awareness alive as long as you can.
I have no idea what the future of rock and roll is. I have no idea. Nor am I really interested.
In the stream of society, why did they lie to me? Got better things to do than write some white man biography.
Future of rock and roll. More surprises, both hideous and wonderful.
Then became the Rumblefish!
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can lose it. Any old time you use it. It's gotta be rock and roll music. If you wanna dance with me. If you wanna dance with me. I have no kick against modern jazz. Unless they try to play it too darn fast. And change the beauty of the melody. Until it sounds just like a symphony. That's why I go for that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it. It's gotta be rock and roll music. If you wanna dance with me. If you wanna dance with me. Don't care to hear them play a tango. I'm in the mood to dig a mambo. Way too early for the Congo. So keep a rocking that piano. So I can hear some of that rock.